Georgia, Georgia.
And today we are going to take a look at Georgia, the last of the 13 colonies founded and the only one to receive direct financial support from London. And so Georgia's an interesting place because it's established in 1733. And you don't need to know all the dates or anything, but just to give you some idea why this is important. That's 126 years after the establishment of Virginia. It's 52 years after the establishment of the 12th colony, Pennsylvania. So this colony is unique for a number of reasons. One of them is the motive behind the crown wanting to establish this colony. And it goes back to this idea of wanting to make sure colonies that are very profitable, Virginia with its tobacco and South Carolina with its rice, they don't feel like they are alone. And one of the primary reasons that Georgia is given money by the crown is that it was supposed to serve as a buffer colony. There was Catholic Spanish Florida, there were French in Louisiana, and England felt like these different rival European countries were potential threats. And there was fighting that took place between England and France and Spain. While wars broke out in Europe, they spilled over to the colonies. There's a feeling that Georgia would serve a defensive purpose as a buffer between South Carolina, Virginia, and some of those other colonies. Now, Georgia is a proprietary colony, and if you forgot what that means the king is giving land to a group of individuals or one individual, and King George II is the guy who gives that grant of land, and of course, for giving away land that he didn't really own,
Georgia.
That's how we got the name Georgia. Now, something important happens, and that is it gets direct financial support. And the reason why England's willing to pay for this is it's kind of like the cost of doing business. It is important, Georgia, for imperial defense. So they give this money, this British loot, to the colony's creators and founders. Partly because it's vulnerable, and you want to be able to make sure that this is successful because it's actually doing England a bit of a favor here. So they start this colony, and the chief guy behind it is a guy with the worst name on earth, James Oglethorpe. And in 1733, the colony is founded. Now, James Oglethorpe is a soldier, he's a political official from England, and he's going to defend the colony against Spanish attacks, and he's also a philanthropist. He has some goals he wants to achieve beyond just being a buffer colony. He's going to serve as the first colony's governor, and one of his chief goals is
convict.
He wants the colony to serve as a way to help prison reform in England. And basically what was going on in England is there were a lot of people in jail. The jails were crowded. And a big reason why is if you were in debt, you were thrown in jail. And James Oglethorpe had a friend who was in jail for not paying his debts, and he dies. And so Oglethorpe's really sensitive to this issue, and he feels Georgia could serve as a penal colony. Basically, what does that mean? People from England, you could relieve the overcrowding in the jails, and they could be transferred over to this colony in the New World to start over. So he's a big advocate of prison reform. He wants to do this thing, and it's partly as a refuge for prisoners. So it's kind of a charity case. Now, he's going to have some rules here. You know, there are going to be special regulations for Georgia that if you wanted to come to the colony, you better follow the rules.
I can follow the rules, and we'll have a good day when we follow the rules.
And those rules included no drinking liquor in the colony. No drinking liquor, and the other one is there would be a ban on slavery. And there's a lot of different reasons why, you know, for instance, one, he envisioned that this colony would be a colony of small farmers. That these farmers would protect the colony of South Carolina and the others because they would be able to defend, and slaves wouldn't do this. Now, indentured servants are allowed to come, but no slavery. We don't want these big plantations like South Carolina had, and that was basically those restrictions. Now, in terms of freedom of religion, you had it except if you were Catholic, and that's part of this rivalry with Spain and the history of the religious battles over in England. So these were the rules, and the colony doesn't really flourish at all. Not a lot of people want to come.
Georgia. Georgia.
And not a lot of people want to come, and there's this feeling of sadness and you know, frustration that the colony is not flourishing. You know, it was invaded by Spanish forces in 1742. Oglethorpe and his guys defeat them by mobilizing the troops. But here's the thing. It's dangerous. It is in a geographically dangerous area. And the big issue why the colony doesn't flourish is because the restrictions on slavery. You don't get a lot of people wanting to come to a colony where they could be killed by Spain or Native Americans or possibly the French, and you can't make this money with slavery. So in 1749, they do lift the ban on slavery, and slavery is allowed, and the colony does grow slowly, but eventually... In 1752, Oglethorpe and his crew pack up, they give up, and Georgia becomes a royal colony. And after that point, slavery is green light, ready to go, the bans on drinking are dropped, and the colony in the years ahead will grow slowly, and it will adopt a system very similar to that of South Carolina. The plantation system, cash crop, and Georgia will struggle. In fact, at the time of the American Revolution, Georgia will probably be the least populous of all 13 of the colonies. Now, something really important I want to close out here with is the South. All about the South. And in all the lectures, we've covered these colonies, and I do want to do a quick sum up of these things. Maryland and Virginia, remember, they belong to that area called the Chesapeake Bay. And North Carolina was formed, and it's kind of a very independent colony, and it has a mix of small farmers. And South Carolina and Georgia are these big plantation economies. There are some characteristics of the southern colonies, and I want to make sure you know them. One is, most of them are dominated by a cash crop. And you can see that on the map when it comes to places like Virginia and Maryland, it's tobacco. When it comes to places like South Carolina, it's rice and indigo. And Georgia to a lesser extent as well. North Carolina is going to take on a tobacco crop economy, nowhere near as big plantation as some of the others. But overall, the economy was based upon staple cash crops. Another thing that you should know is that southern colonies were very strictly defined by wealth and hierarchy. And what I mean by that is in all of them, the elite in those societies were the planters, the people that owned the plantations. And the people who owned the plantations tended to be the ones who owned slaves. And for instance, in Virginia, it is the planters who dominate politics in the House of Burgess. So the South is very much a hierarchical society, and wealth and the gap between the rich and the poor grows pretty large. Another thing is, as a result of this agricultural economy, very few cities develop. Yeah, you got Charleston and you got Savannah, Georgia, but if you look at it and you compare it with the economy of the North and the Middle colonies, much more cities, much more of a mixed economy as well. And this one's the big and the important thing. The institution of labor relations in the South. You are going to have indentured servants from the early period and all the way up to the American Revolution. But remember, with events such as Bacon's Rebellion in Virginia in 1676, more and more you're going to have the importation, the forced importation of slaves. And you can look at this map and you can see very clearly that when it comes to Southern society, in some colonies, especially South Carolina and Virginia, and later on Georgia, once the ban on slavery is lifted, slave labor, African immigrants, are going to make up a big percent of the population. Remember, in South Carolina, the majority. Whereas if you compare that with the middle and the north New England colonies, you're going to have much more of a mix. But it gets even more complicated because you're going to have Scots-Irish immigrants coming in and a whole wave of different groups going to different parts of the British Empire. So make sure you know some of the key things about Southern economy, social structure. The planters were the big guys, but they're also the biggest group were the small farmers. And in places like North Carolina, they dominate. Thank you for watching. You gotta love Georgia. Georgia.
Georgia.
Ray Charles is gonna take you out. If you're studying for APUSH, those are the material, the info you should know. And as always, thank you for watching. Transform your life and subscribe to Jost Productions. Support these free videos on the internet. And once again, peace.